Hello, in this lecture, we're going to discuss Confucianism. We're going to discuss founders and the major contributors of Confucianism. Origin, core ideas, role of education and personal cultivation, transformation of Confucianism into a conservative perspective, Confucianism in modern times. Founders and contributors. The founding of Confucianism obviously can be traced to this person, Confucius. In Chinese, they call him Kongfuzi or Kongzi. Kongzi. Kong is his last name. Zi is a way of addressing people with great knowledge. So it's so Kongzi actually means Master Kong. So Kongzi is in Chinese, but in English eventually it changed into Confucius. In addition to Confucius, there are other major contributors to Confucianism. Mencius or Mengzi, Dong Zhongshu, and Zhu Xi. So these are several important contributors to Confucianism throughout Chinese history. Now, before we get into the origin of Confucianism, we need to discuss a little bit about historical background. The very first Chinese dynasty with written history was the Shang Dynasty, from 1600 to 1046 BC. The Shang Dynasty was followed by the Zhou Dynasty. But the Zhou Dynasty can be divided into two sub-periods. The Western Zhou Dynasty, where the capital location was in a Western city, Xi'an. And the Eastern Zhou Dynasty, when the capital moved into an eastern location, Luoyang. During the Western Zhou Dynasty, things largely peaceful, prosperous, and harmonious. During the Eastern Zhou Dynasty, there are chaos. There's a collapse of social order, and there's a rise of local lord. The Eastern Zhou Dynasty itself can be divided into two sub-periods, the Spring and Autumn period and Warring State period. The Spring and Autumn period saw many small countries, states, small states fighting each other. And during the Warring State period, all the small states consolidated into seven large states. So this map shows the political fragmentation of China during the Spring and Autumn period. Each small blue letter character indicates a small state. So the society is very fragmented, a lot of war, a lot of bloodshed. Confucius largely lived during the Spring and Autumn period and selected a few years into the Warring State period. So anyway, he lived in this period of time with a lot of wars and chaos and bloodshed. Now here we come to the origin of Confucianism. With the chaos of society, with collapse of order in society, a lot of intellectuals and politicians at the time rose to the challenge of the time. They tried to find the solution to the problem, and they want to end the chaos and restore order and harmony, as seen in the Western Zhou Dynasty, when things are very peaceful and prosperous and harmonious. And Confucius was one such scholar. He wants also find something, find a solution to end the chaos and restore social order. What he did is to look back into the Shang Dynasty and the Western Zhou Dynasty. He wanted to figure out what was there that makes those dynasty, make those early dynasty so united and so peaceful, so harmonious. And eventually, he found something from those earlier period of times, and he further developed those old ideas into a new system, Confucianism. So this result of his search is to synthesize and further develop ideas from the Shang and the Western Zhou dynasty. And eventually he came up with some results. And this result is a moral and ethic system that is based upon the blood bonds within the family and the social hierarchy within the society. And he wants to use this kind of moral and ethic system to guide people's behavior so that we can eventually achieve social harmony and restore social order. Now, the core ideas of Confucianism can be summarized by three words or three characters: Ren, Yi, Li. Ren, Yi, Li. So let's start with Ren. Ren can be translated into humanness, benevolence, being nice to other people, and love for mankind, love for family and non-family members, this love, being nice to each other. But this love is not the equal love, it is graded love. Fathers or patriarchs in a family deserve the most love. The rulers in a society deserve the most love. And everyone undone deserves less. So there's a hierarchy within the family, and also there's a hierarchy within the society outside the family. So you know, the ruler deserves more, and everyone undone deserves less. Patriarch within the family is deserve most respect. You know, all other people have to stand when they take pictures. So there's a hierarchy. Okay. Well, love itself does not really solve all the problems. You need to have standard for love. You cannot have wrong kind of love. You cannot support your child to be a criminal. You love your child, but you encourage yourself to encourage your child to be to do the wrong thing. That's not good. That's when we come to the second word, Yi. Yi can be translated to righteousness, appropriateness, justice, being ethical. So the word Yi really helps to define the nature of love. You need to have the right kind of love, not wrong kind of love. So this really proposes a highest ethic standard in education and the personal cultivation. Now, what are the right kind of love? What are the behavior that is consistent with the principle of Yi? Well, here are a few standards. You know, strive for self-cultivation, fulfill family duties, serve the state, serve the country, govern a territory. And when you do all this, you need to do in your full effort, even when it is need for your self-sacrifice. When you even you lose your own life, you need to do that. And this is the right thing to do. Now, what are the behavior of non-Yi? Behavior that are not consistent with the principle of Yi. Not right, not righteous behavior. And that is anything opposite to all this above that we mentioned, not strive for self-cultivation, not fulfilling family duty, not serve the state, not govern a territory, and not in full effort, and do not want to be losing your own interest, do not want to lose your own life. In addition, those behaviors that aimed at selfish material gains or self-preservation, so those are regarded as behavior of non-yi. Now let's look at some examples of behavior of yi. Here is some very famous examples here. The picture on the left shows this example of filial piety. Filial piety is a concept that indicates, that encompasses ideas that anybody who show loyalty, show respect, and show care to their parents, their ancestors, to the elderly, to anybody who are older than them. So this is the concept of filial piety. So you have this example of filial piety. A son, his mother was sick, and so he would then he went out to go to the river. This is a winter day, and the river all frozen up. So he took off his clothes and put his naked body on the ice. He want to use his warm body to melt ice so that he can catch the fish for his mother. So that is a classical story of a filial piety. It's passed down from ancient Chinese history. Another example is picture on the right that involves this historical figure, Yue Fei. Yue Fei was a military general who lived in the Southern Song Dynasty. The Southern Song Dynasty was invaded by a tribe to the north. And when they invaded the Southern Song Dynasty, they captured two emperors from the dynasty and kept them prisoner. Now, Yue Fei, as a general, as a subordinate to those captured emperors, he feels a sense of duty to rescue them. Regardless of what's going to happen to him, he wants to rescue them. But now this would bring personal risk to him, because the sitting emperor did not want those captured emperors to be rescued, because if they come back, what's going to happen to the sitting emperor? And people know that Yue Fei was risking his own life and tried to rescue those captured emperors. But Yue Fei insists on going to rescue those captured emperors because his duty to those emperors. Even if he's risking losing his own life, his self-sacrifice. Eventually, he was executed by the sitting emperor. But this example shows what is righteous behavior. It's a high ethic standard behavior. Yeah. Even for rulers, there are some standard for rulers. Mencius proposes a Ren behavior that conforming to the principle of yi. As a ruler, they should be benevolent ruler, benevolent governing, and virtuous rule. And that is what they should do as a ruler. They should lead by virtue and propriety. They should lighten penalties and lighten the punishment and reduce taxes and reduce hard labor levy. And that is the standard for the ruler. And this, the gate at the, in this picture shows a big gate in the Korean Imperial Palace. The big gate, gate on the three character says benevolent governing gate. Confucianism have also very influential in Korea as well. Now we come to the third word, Li. Li Yi's intent to propose to set up a system of rituals and etiquette that reflect the principles of Ren and Yi, and try to establish some norms and protocols that are expected of everyone given his or her position within the family and society. It also set some kind of rules to follow, some duties to fulfill for everyone in various kind of circumstances and social relations. And that kind of system can be well summarized by so-called five cardinal relations. Confucius scholars set up, summarize these five cardinal relations to cover all possible social relations. Now you have this five pairs of relations between the ruler and the subordinate, between the father and the son, between the husband and the wife, between the older siblings and the younger sibling, and outside the family, between an older person and a younger person. As you can see, that each pair of relations involves this first party who is regarded as superior, and the second party who is regarded as inferior. Given their superior and inferior positions in each of the relations, they also have their expected roles to play. The superior party is supposed to play a role to guide, dominate the inferior party, but also they should show love and care and teach the inferior party. At the same time, the inferior party, their role is expect to be showing loyalty and being subordinate to the superior party and show respect. They should follow and learn from the superior party. So that's the five cardinal relations, and that's how the system is set up and how it works. Okay. Now each person is in a web of social relation, and each relation is a person is either in a superior position or in an inferior position. Like you are in school, you have your professor. Obviously with professor you are in a inferior position. The professor is in a superior position. But you have your work, and in your work you are a little manager, and you have your person who work for you, and therefore you are in a superior position. And then the person who work for you are in a inferior position. And in your house, you have your parents, and with them you are in an inferior position. But within your own small family, you are a parent. Therefore, to your child, you are in a superior position. So you have this web of relation, and each of the relation you are either a superior party or in an inferior party. Now, you should be expected to follow the role expected for each of the position in each of these relations. So at home, you are to your child, you are superior party. Therefore, you should show loving and care to your child. But at work, you have your own boss, so you should show respect and show loyalty to your own boss because you are the inferior party. So you are expected to know the role in each of those relations in your web of social relations. But if everyone in society does the same thing, they follow the same rule, they all follow the rule of the game, therefore, the entire society will be in harmony. The order will follow, and harmony would prevail. So this is how the Confucius, ideas of to restore the harmony in society, restore order and restore harmony in society. He set up this a set of moral ethic system for people to follow, and for rulers follow, to officials follow, for family members follow. Everyone in society is expected to follow. And if everyone does it, and the society will be in harmony. So this is the idea of Confucianism.